Explosions racked the space above you, loud and factitious. The air was alive with dust and fragments and grunts and cries of battle. Kirishima, Bakugou, and you were engaged in combat with a group of mid-grade villains, each of you having your own challenges to the irritable team. Katsuki was frantic with frustration, his quirks setting off in rapid succession in an attempt to counter his opponent's quirk. With each explosion, the villain would pull an inanimate object to shield against pure dynamite. Having just taken down your own villain, you watch Katsuki's movements and wait for an opportune moment to intervene. As the mailbox beside you begins to lift off the floor, you made a split-second decision and latch onto it. As the large blue box propelled itself to its master, both Katsuki and the villain were suspended in surprise. You took the convenient pause and jumped the villain, successfully using your quirk to push him back. He was disorientated for a mere moment, but more than enough time for Katsuki to combine an attack to his face. You smirk as the man crumpled to the ground. Katsuki whooped you and growled with annoyance. "I didn't need your help," you winked to the hidden thing. "No problem." You both turn away in search of your third companion. Ejiro was up against an air repulsion quirk. He dug his hardened legs into the asphalt and his arms crossed in front of him to shield against the rapid hurricane that was propelled towards him in a line of swirling wind. It was not an easy stalemate to escape. "Take him from the back. I'll get his flank," you say to Katsuki before charging forward. "Don't fucking tell me what to do," Katsuki yells, but follows the orders anyway. As he comes up from behind, his explosions alert the villain. The villain tears one hand away from his assault on Ejiro and flings it to the other side in a motion like lifting a heavy shot put. The wind sends dynamite flying back, but Katsuki, agile and quick-thinking even in the air, grabs onto a light pole. You rush forward to tackle the villain, expecting him to be too distracted to put up a fight. You leap into the air, but the villain's eyes flick to yours and you falter with realization. He forces both his hands forward. You barely had time to let out a small gasp before the winds throw you back, flying like a home run in baseball. You try to use your quirk to soften the impact you were destined to make, but the force of hitting the concrete of the building behind you is still jarring against your bones. You shut your eyes against the smarting and try to block out the uncomfortable feeling of the hurricane attacking you. It was like something cold, heavy, and malleable pressing you deeper into the surface of the building. Suddenly, the rushing sound of howling wind halted and you were dropped to the ground. You had enough sense to bend your knees as you fell, but when you were safely on the ground, your legs trembled lightly. You look up to find that Ejiro and Katsuki had basically flattened the guy between them and left him in a discarded mess on the floor. Their eyes searched for you amongst the destruction. Katsuki yelled brashly, "Dumbass, shout if you're not dead." You laugh a little as you approach, giving a small, "Not dead." Immediately, Ejiro surges forward to inspect your injuries. His wide eyes roam the little scratches and searches for blood. The concern warms your heart. "Are you hurt?" "Barely," you reply with a soft smile. Katsuki grumbled from their side, his eyes darting up and down your form as though he was doing his own inspection. "Was being flung into a building part of your plan?" You chuckle nervously. "Nah, but thanks for having my back." Ejiro chirped cheerily. "Always. So, go get yourself checked, idiot. You might have a concussion." By the time the authorities arrived, you, Ejiro, and Katsuki had rounded up the unconscious villains and placed them in a neat circle for the police to arrest efficiently. The police took custody of the small group of five villains and departed with a friendly thanks to their local heroes. You sat at the edge of an ambulance, letting the paramedics tend to the worst of your injuries, while Katsuki and Ejiro hovered. You tried to suppress your smile. In the last 2 months following the breakup, both men had been so attentive. They insisted on regular hangouts and ensured that most dinners would be eaten together. Katsuki went as far as to threaten the other heroes in the agency not to sign up for patrols with you, so that you had spent almost every waking hour with the boys. You felt loved and cared for by your friends, but couldn't help but worry that you may have been cutting into their couple time. You tried to exclude yourself once in a while, but the hangout would just end up being at your house. Eventually, you decided that maybe you should bring it up with them to make sure you weren't overstepping, but you had never gotten around to asking. The last 2 months were just too blissful to disrupt. Was it wrong for you to sink into the happiness when you had been so miserable before? The paramedic leaned back as they finished their work on you and said positively, "These wounds will heal. They're just superficial. You may have some bruising and tenderness, but if you start vomiting or getting major headaches, please make your way to the hospital." "Thanks, I will," you say before getting up to celebrate the victory with your boys. "Guess who's just fine," you say triumphantly. Katsuki rolled his eyes and said, "Great, let's go home." Adria and you filled the car with happy chatter. Despite the grey sky that threatened rain, the confines of the car was warm and bright, as though it had its own personal sun tucked away. Adria and you traded back and forth discussing the fight that had happened as he drove on the mostly still streets. "I was starting to think all the difficult villains retired," you say jokingly. "I mean, not like I like the damage and destruction, but we haven't had a worthwhile incident like that in ages." "Shut up, they weren't even high-end villains." Katsuki popped into the conversation from the passenger seat with a roll of his eyes. "Is that why you had so much trouble with that one?" you tease lightly. "I wasn't having trouble," Katsuki shouted back, then grumbled. "He was just being fucking annoying." "Well, it's a good thing I took care of it for you then," you say snarkily. Katsuki growled his irritation. I'm sorry," you giggle, in the hopes to save him. "The way you guys saved me though, that was pretty awesome." "You were being reckless," Katsuki griped. "Not really," you counter. "I mean, he had a tricky quirk to get around." Kirishima chimed in seriously. "Sorry, Pebble, I have to agree with Katsuki. You could have gotten hurt badly. In fact, you did get hurt badly." "Oh, come on. A couple bruises got nothing on me," you say, playing it off, though your back did ache with little movements. "You guys got some scrapes too. Don't act like I'm the only one." "Well, we didn't get anything like you, dumbass," Katsuki fussed. You sigh, choosing defeat over arguing with Katsuki. You stare out the window as the first drop struck, then a million more pattering softly into the glass, racing each other to get to the ground. You silently jeer for your favorite raindrops. When your eyes focus beyond the raindrop jockeys, you yell, "Stop!" Edro stomped the brakes immediately and the car lurched to halt. Both boys swivel to find a source of danger. Katsuki was the first to ask, "What happened?" "Let's go to the playground," you holler with childish glee. Katsuki facepalmed and groaned. "It's fucking raining, idiot." "So?" you say simply. You pout to Edro, begging silently with big pleading eyes. "Come on, it'll be fun. I'll even push you on the swing." A soft smirk spread on Edro's lips and he relented, still grinning as he turned into the playground parking lot. "Yes!" you shout victoriously. The cooling rain washed over you like a refreshing shower on a hot summer's day. Edro follows you out of the car, but Katsuki sat stubbornly with his arms crossed. "Come on, Katsuki, please," you whine. "No," Katsuki replied curtly, "I hate the rain." "Okay, I know that, but could you at least come out of the car? There's a small thatch over there you can stay under and watch. But I'd really like if you could be with us." Grumbling still, Katsuki pulled out his big umbrella and followed them. At the risk of Katsuki's reaction time, you thrust your hand out in a mere millisecond and jab a finger at him. You shout as you run, "Tag, you're it, no quirks." "Get back here," Katsuki bellows, chasing after you, the umbrella discarded. You take off for the metal slide turned water slide by Mother Nature's bull. Edro cut Katsuki off, effectively creating a human wall for Katsuki to collide with. "Run, Pebble, I'll hold him off." "Edro," you giggle, "now you're it." "Oh, right," Edro says, then reflexively makes a grab for Katsuki, who managed to jump out of his grasp and evade. Edro's eyes then zero in on you, and you dash up the slide. Edro climbs after you, his shark-like teeth gleaming even in the dimness of the day. In a small, playful panic to get away, you rashly push off the slide. You slink down the slippery metal and land securely at the end with both your feet planted in the mud. You attempt to get off when a large force shoves you forward. You collapse into the mud, thankfully on your hands and knees, avoiding your face full of mud, Save for a little cool splatter, Eiichiro began to ramble an apology. I am so sorry, I didn't mean for that to happen. Splat! You dug your hand into the mud and hurled a healthy helping into Eiichiro's shirt. You froze in a wide open mouthed smile, a little surprised by your own impulsive decision. Eiichiro's head dropped to his shirt, and a big toothy grin split his face with mischief. Oh, it's on! Eiichiro leaned down and scooped a ball of mud in a swift motion and propelled it. You dodge, running for cover among the other playground items. Katsuki, who'd finally made it over to the thatch, yelled above the rain. Will you two knock it off? If one of you injure yourself, I am not taking you to the hospital. You can both suffer and die. You swerve around the thatch, ducking behind Katsuki just as Eiichiro threw another mud ball at you. There was a tug at your arm and then Katsuki yanks you in front of him. The mud ball splatters across you. Hey, watch it. I'm not playing this stupid game of yours, he chided. You face Katsuki with a pout. You would sacrifice me to save yourself? Katsuki glares at you with no remorse. If it means staying mud-free, yes. With a wild grin, you hoist your arms around Katsuki's torso, smothering him in a mud-caked hug. He instantly shoves you off, harshly. You stumble back, thankfully, into Eiichiro's firm chest. Katsuki seethed in rage as he held his arms apart from his body, as though they'd somehow worsened the beautiful mud masterpiece you'd created of him. What the actual fuck? I'm going to kill you, Shine! Eiichiro had already succumbed to a fit of giggles and offers as Katsuki approaches with murder in his eyes. Get behind me. I'll protect you. No way, you say immediately. We'll fight him together. I'm not leaving you. You ready yourself for Katsuki's assault at Kirishima's side. Fine by me. I'll crush you both, Katsuki yelled, before launching himself at you. You move to act, but Kirishima hardens and blocks Katsuki with his forearm. Katsuki gnarls angrily. You're so lucky I can't use my explosions. In his distracted state, you land a solid kick to his stomach. He tripped on his feet and tumbled into a large puddle of muddy water. He shot up, snarling like an unhappy freshly bathed cat, and attacked again. The game of cat and mice lasted a while longer before Katsuki managed to get his hands around your neck. He drove you onto the playground floor, knocking the wind from your lungs. Then, victoriously scooped a large amount of mud and smashed it all along your front. His hand traveled with torpid triumph, gradual in its descent. As the mud thinned, Katsuki's rough hand solidified as a pressure roaming your shirt, grazing sensitive places through the weakened material of your soaked t-shirt. Your breath hitched at the shock of the very present event and tried to play it off. Katsuki was too absorbed in his victory to notice the compromising position he'd put you in. I fucking win, cause I'm the best, he howled to the heavens. Kirishima caught up with the both of you, huffing with a queer smile. Katsuki? Only then did Katsuki's eyes focus on his hand placed on your stomach and himself straddling your waist. Within the next half second, he was on his feet, mumbling and avoiding your eyes. Shut up! Can we go home now? I'm fucking freezing! Kirishima chuckled quietly and offered a hand for you to stand up. We'll win next time. You wink with confidence. For sure. We should probably get home soon. It'll be dark in an hour or so. Wait here, I think I have some towels in the back of the car. We can try and clean up a bit. Eiichiro departed for the car, leaving you standing under the thatch with a grumpy Katsuki. Huffing in irritation, there was an awkward silence that settled over you two, and you frowned. Had that play fight made the air around you tense? This was a complete turnaround from the fun that lit his actions just moments ago. You hate to maintain this awkwardness and scramble for a way to show him that what happened didn't matter. The three of you were just playing after all. A moment such as that could have easily have occurred in a sparring session. As you watch the rain pour and droplets shower the thatch sticks, an idea plops into your head. You ease your hand into the curtain of rain before submerging yourself. You begin to sway along with the peaceful drone of water, taking up no particular rhythm but enjoying the airy freestyle liberating your limbs. Katsuki narrowed his eyes at your movements. What are you doing? Dancing, you say shortly and disturb the linear lines of descending water with the curvy oscillation of your hips. Katsuki rolled his eyes with no real malice. There's no music, he says bluntly. Yes, there is, you shoot back. You just need to listen closely. You seal your lips and commence a tune to take form. Humming, you swirl around Katsuki, tempting him to the freedom that came a dancing carelessly in the rain. Gradually, you slip your hand into his, with the same care you take in approaching a stray cat. He protests, I'm not dancing in the rain with you, forget it. But your hands are still linked. You stay where you are and move your hands, now clasped in Katsuki, up and down to the beat you created, until the weariness faded from his eyes, bit by bit, and his arms felt a little lighter in your grasp. Katsuki joined you at a crawling pace, but soon mimicked your sway. You liven your footsteps and beam at him when he meets the challenge. Katsuki and you harmonize to the melody of your humming, and to the lovely pitter-patter of droplets falling into the shallow puddles. Your twists and turns agitate the ripples in the surface of the mini lake. Katsuki indulges you by raising his hand and allowing you to twirl to your contentment. As the seconds flit by, a smile graces Katsuki's lips, but not any smile. This was Katsuki's smile. Raw and pure, where he had no control of it, and precious in its rarity. Your hands form on his shoulders and his skim your waist before tightening and drawing you closer. Katsuki's heat invaded your space as though the sun possessed the small area, this little whirlpool isolated from the rest of the world, where it was just Katsuki and you, and fiery crimson being the only emboldened color in a landscape of gray. The vague pull was subtle at first, nothing beyond a gentle feeling at the lesser distance. But as two bodies neared, their gravities lured them the rest of the way, and lips collided. Your eyes shut, ignoring the steady thrum of raindrops knocking on your eyelids. The only feeling encompassing your being was the press of Katsuki's heated lips on yours, the pressure of his hold and the comfort of his arms around you. When you draw away, still in the blissful bubble at this moment, you meet his eyes and find only love and longing in them. A flash of red catches in the corner of your vision and your bubble pops. The rain is suddenly too loud in your ears. The mass of red hair rounded a corner hurriedly. You're struck with the horror of what you'd just done. You hastily shove Katsuki back, your heart thumping painfully against your ribcage, your lungs struggling for breath. Oh my word! Katsuki, I'm so sorry, I don't know what came over me. Wait, Katsuki interrupts, annoyance coloring his voice. You're in a relationship, you say incredulously, as though the fact had not been known to you this entire time. I just saw Kirishima. You have to go explain this to him. You have to tell him this was my fault, that he shouldn't blame you. I'm so sorry, I didn't mean to cause problems for you. I don't know what I was thinking, I... You were spiraling. For months, Kirishima and Bakugou had been your steady points of comfort, your friends at your lowest point, and yet, you'd ruined everything by not thinking or having any semblance of self-control. Worse, you'd caused a problem in their relationship, their perfect relationship that was filled with the most heartwarming love, and you carved a rift in that. Hot tears rolled down your cheeks, dissolving into the overflow of cold rain. How could you do that to them? The air was thin, and a dizziness swept your shaking body. You wanted to walk away, but your bearings shifted, your internal compass spiraling. You take a step away, but a strong hand clamps around your wrist, then a grounding encumbrance crushing your body's tremors. Katsuki's hot breath brushes your ear. You need to calm down. You didn't do anything wrong, okay? Just breathe for a second, alright? Let me explain. No, you say as you push against him. You shouldn't be explaining to me. You have to explain to Kirishima. You have to fix your relationship. Tell him it was my fault. It's not your fault, Katsuki growls impatiently. I kissed you. You're overwhelmed with the weight of what he just said and what it could mean. You shake your head slowly and steady your voice as much as you could. Katsuki, I don't care what just happened between us. I will not do anything to hurt Kirishima. I love you both too much to do that. So go and fucking fix things with your boyfriend now. You expected some reaction, whether further protests or even him to walk away. But he merely stared intensely for a stretched out moment, letting the raindrops drip from his water-heavy blonde locks. Then he said quietly, we're both in love with you. Your first response was a disbelieving, "What? We are both in love with you," Katsuki repeated, louder and clearer, glaring at you as though to force the message through your eyes. You are at a loss for words, only jumbled confusion escaping. "But you're both together. We love each other too," Katsuki continues. "But we both love you. We both have wanted to be with you, even from before you broke up with that idiot ex of yours, Ejiro and I." But if that was true, why did he run? You're lying. You couldn't help but stutter, the statement not sitting right on your tongue. Katsuki didn't lie. Katsuki's stare had not broken once. "You know that's not true. I would never want to hurt Ejiro. And if you don't believe me, let us both go to him. You can find out for yourself." Katsuki reaches for your hand, and though you hesitate, you take it. Ejiro wasn't sure why he'd run. As he approached, tail shielded from the downpour by a plastic packet in tow, he'd pause at the sight before him. You and Katsuki swirling amongst the puddles, creating little fountains with each plunge into the shallow waters. The hidden sun had long since started its descent, and yet, the two figures seemed to brighten the air around them. They were two stars caught in each other's gravitational pull, and Ejiro's heart clenched at the thought of how perfect the moment was. Without him, it dawned on him that perhaps you would prefer to be with only Katsuki, and not him. Katsuki was so encompassed by your light, as was Ejiro, but he realized that should you choose to be with Katsuki, he would let go for both your happiness. He would love you both from afar. That would be the right thing to do, wouldn't it? When you and Katsuki kissed, the seal had been stamped on his resolve. However, he couldn't stay and watch as he lost the two most important people in his life. Ejiro ducked behind a nearby building, crouching behind the solid structure. His throat seized with tears. He clutched his shirt, hoping the pain of his chest would subside, and yet it only festered with each passing second. He stayed on the ground. He barely noticed the voice over his struggle to control his emotions. "Hey." Ejiro found Katsuki staring down at him. He had his scowl on his face, but a small crinkle at his eyebrow that showed concern. Ejiro rose from the ground and attempted nonchalance to cover up the fact that he'd been crying. "Hey, I slipped. You always write about how I shouldn't wear my Crocs around." Katsuki's blood-red eyes narrowed sharply with conviction. "Right. It has nothing to do with the kiss you just saw." Ejiro's sharp teeth caught onto his bottom lip, and he couldn't meet Katsuki's eyes, caught in his lie. He only replied with a smile. "I'm happy for you both." Katsuki snapped savagely. "I thought this was something you wanted. Do you not want them anymore?" "I want them to be happy. I want you to be happy," Ejiro said, near desperate to make him understand. "If the both of you will be happy without me in the picture, I can accept that." Katsuki clicked his tongue. "Tuh, that's so." Ejiro nodded solemnly, then realized you weren't there. He asked Katsuki, "Where are they?" "Crying their eyes out because they feel like they fucked up our relationship," Katsuki answers bluntly. "I came here to find out if that's true." Ejiro faltered in shock and worry. "Pebble is crying? You have to go to them." "I swear to God," Katsuki groaned. "You're both such dumbasses. You say go to them, they tell me to go to you." Katsuki stomped over to Ejiro, grabbing onto his collar and pulling him down forcefully into a ragged, punishing kiss. "I guess that's why I fell for you, idiots." Katsuki tightened his grip. "Let's get one thing clear here. Yeah? I might love them, but I love you as well, and I will not ditch you for them. Now I need you to tell me, is this not something you want anymore?"
"They don't seem to want me to."
"Answer the fucking question," Katsuki hissed.
Your image bloomed in Ejiro's mind. Little moments that could easily be mistaken for being mundane, but that had meant the world to Ejiro. The feeling of having you close by his side, and he answered Katsuki's question honestly. "I want them more than anything." Timid hands wrapped around Ejiro's torso. You can have it, you whispered like a secret only meant for him.
Pebble!
Adria whooped around to face you. Your hands began wringing themselves in nervousness. I was afraid when you ran away, scared that I'd ruined our friendship. I needed to hear how you felt myself. I love both you and Katsuki. You both have been with me through everything, and I would never want to do anything to hurt either of you. Adria couldn't believe what he was hearing. His heart resurrected after the plummet it had taken only a few moments ago. His pebble was standing in front of him, confessing. He was purely dumbfounded. He noticed the way you wrung your hands a little tighter as the moment dragged on. While Edro tried to process, he scrambled for something to say.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to scare you.
It's alright, you say. I'm sorry I kissed your boyfriend. No matter what, that was wrong of me. I'm sorry. You faced the ground with guilt. Edro could see the strain his actions had placed on you.
You can make it up to me,
Edro offered playfully. Taking a step forward, he said, return the kiss to me. Wide eyes shut up, somewhat hopeful, and you say, gladly. You lean in, rising on the tips of your toes, and capture Edrio's lips with yours. He embraces you in his warmth, and you taste the sweet rain on his tongue. You are more conscious of this kiss than the one you shared with Katsuki, aware that Katsuki was a few steps away, watching. You pull back, unfamiliar on the protocols of this type of situation, but feeling the need to confirm with Katsuki. Is this really okay? Katsuki canceled those few steps and grabbed your hands roughly. We want you. Edro nuzzled against the side of your head. We love you. Katsuki shifted closer, and you were near smothered in warmth, shielded from the chill that came with the light storm and nighttime falling. You smile softly with comfort. This is going to take some getting used to, but I would like to try. Kissing was made for two people, but it is not the only gesture of love there is. Edro, in his excitement, pulled you and Katsuki into an enormous and heartfelt hug. His arms were tight in elation and love. Katsuki huffed in faint annoyance, but didn't pull away. His arms snuck around you, below Edro's. In that moment, the rain was barely dust falling on your skin. Everything else fell away as though the little plot you three stood on was cut out of the universe and reserved for you to share. You squeeze the two men against your sides and think, how lucky I am to be loved so dearly by these two amazing men.